If you watched The Last Dance earlier this quarantine, you know that the 97-98 Chicago Bulls was the last season the whole squad would be together. Hence why Phil Jackson named that season The Last Dance. This would be their last time together because GM Jerry Krause wanted to get rid of Phil Jackson before the season started. Logically, most of the players such as Michael Jordan and Scottie Pippen would have preferred to have Jackson stay as the coach. And Michael Jordan even came out and stated that he wouldn't want to play for any other head coach that isn't Phil Jackson. Obviously, because of the documentary, we know the events that took place that season and the seasons prior to that. But not all of us know the details of the season after The Last Dance, the 98-99 Chicago Bulls. Here's the story of that 98-99 Chicago Bulls. Before the 1998-99 NBA season took place, there was a lockout. This is the third and longest lockout in league history. It lasted from July 1st, 1998 to January 20th, 1999. The season was shortened to 50 games, and this resulted in a 1999 All-Star game being canceled, alongside the three-point contest and the dunk contest, and other All-Star events. The first party in this dialogue were the NBA owners. In 1998, the owners reopened the league's collective bargaining agreement, known as the CBA, as they were looking to change the salary cap system. The other party in this case is the National Basketball Players Association, and they did not want this to happen at all. But they wanted raises for players who earn minimum salary, such as bench warmers and stuff like that. A good example of a superstar who earned a small amount of money was also Scottie Pippen, and we know this because of the Last Dance documentary. If you didn't know what the CBA is the process where working employees, or in this case, athletes, negotiate contracts with their employers, in this case, it's the team owners, to determine their terms of employment. This includes pay, benefits, leave, safety policies, and etc. Both parties failed to reach the agreement, and ultimately, the owners began the lockout. Prior to this lockout, there was a lockout in 95 and in 1996. In 1995, the six-year CBA was put in place, but it also had a clause allowing owners to reopen the deal after 3 years if more than 51.8% of quote-unquote basketball-related income went to player salaries. In the 97-98 NBA season, 57% of this income was used to pay players. Exhibition games were canceled and training camps were postponed indefinitely because of stalled talks between the two parties. Fast forward to December 1998, there was still no deal. Even former Commissioner David Stern recommended to cancel the season overall if a deal wasn't made by January 7th, 1999. On January 7th, 1999, NBPA Director Billy Hunter and David Stern struck a deal, which was ratified by the two parties. A deal was finally made official on January 20th, 1999, ending the lockout after 204 long days. This is considered a win for Stern and the owners. This deal capped players' salaries between $9 million and $14 million, and depending on how long the athlete had played in the league. For example, someone like, at this time, Charles Barkley, Hakeem Olajuwon, and like Patrick Ewing would get more money than someone who was drafted a couple seasons prior to this lockout. A rookie pay scale was also introduced in this deal. Salary increase tied to how early a player was selected in the upcoming drafts. For example, Zion Williamson would get a higher salary since he was the first pick in the previous draft, and someone like DeJuan Hernandez, who was the 59th pick, would receive less money. The NBA officially became the first major sports organization in the USA to limit the salaries of its own players. On June 23, 1998, just 9 days after winning his sixth title in 8 years, Phil Jackson resigned as head coach, and that slot was officially vacant. Coming into the 1998 NBA draft, the Bulls had the 28th pick, the 34th pick, and the 58th pick. Corey Benjamin was selected with the Bulls' first-round pick, and Shamon Williams, alongside Maceo Baston, if I pronounced the name right, was selected with the Bulls' second-round picks. Shamet Williams was quickly traded to the Hawks for some guy named Corey Carr, a 1999 second-round pick, and a 2000 second-round pick. Fast forward to January 13, 1999, Michael Jordan retired for the second time in his career. The rumors of Jordan retiring the season prior turned out to be true, which led to the Chicago Bulls exploding their team completely. Tim Floyd was hired by the Bulls to be their head coach for the upcoming season, and this is where the complete meltdown happened. January 21st, 1999, Dennis Rodman was waived. Benchwarmers Joe Klein and Judd Buchler were also waived. Steve Kerr was traded to the Spurs for Chuck Person, who was also immediately waived as well, funny isn't it, and a 2000 first round pick. Free agents David Cornai, whatever his name is, I don't know how to pronounce it, and Charles Jones were picked up on the same day. The next day, longtime Bull and icon Scottie Pippen was traded to the Houston Rockets for this guy named Roy Rogers, who was also waived after acquiring him. What's this trend of waiving players after acquiring them? And a 2000 second-round pick. The Bulls also traded their 2001 second-round pick to Milwaukee for this guy named Andrew Lang. And the day after, starting center Luke Longley was sent to Phoenix for Mark Bryant, Martin Mouryshev, and Bubba Wells, alongside the 1991 first-round pick. Mouryshev and Wells were also waived. Isn't that funny, huh? Fun fact, the first-round pick acquired from the trade later turned out to be Ron Artest, or better known as Better World Peace by younger fans. Scott Burrell was also waived 2 days later after the Luke Longley trade. On the same day, the Bulls got their big signing of that quote-unquote offseason by signing Brent Berry to a 6-year, $27 million deal. Brent Berry was a solid player back in the day, you know. He averaged a good 10 points per game. He was on second in the all-rookie team in 96, and was also the 1996 slam dunk champ. So, I mean, wasn't that bad of a signing, I guess. After all of these transactions were completed, the Bulls were ready to tank and rebuild their team from the ground up. Toni Kukoč would be the best player on this team, while Ron Harper and Brent Berry would be his best teammates. This is the Bulls roster coming into the shortened 1998-99 season. I've sorted the roster out in three segments. The green group is the guys who are part of that three-peat team. The yellow guys is the guys that you may know from video games like 2K or something like that. And lastly, the guys in red are the jabronis of this team, the players that nobody knows or even remembers at all. In one offseason, the Bulls went from this to this. February 5th, 1999 marked the return of the NBA and return of the newly, albeit very, very, very weak Bulls team. The Bulls faced the Jazz, who were the runners-up for two seasons in a row, but this was no finals rematch. This was men against boys. As looking at the Bulls starting lineup, you could see that this was going to be a long 50-game season. The Jazz eventually prevailed as they beat the Bulls 104-96 with five players having more than 15 points. Chicago played their first game on January 9th, 1999 at home, and the scenes in the United Center were definitely unpleasant. The fact that they had the nerve to use the iconic intro baffles me, as this lot, aside from the actual champs, don't deserve to hear that intro at all in the United Center. The Bulls lost to the Hawks, well, no surprise there, as most of the team struggled to shoot the ball, including Toni Kukoč and Ron Harper. That game was the start of a 7-game losing streak as the Bulls struggled to score over 80 points, as they only did that in 2 of 7 games during that stretch. In fact, the Bulls scored more than 100 points 3 times the whole season. The Bulls had another 7-game losing streak towards the end of the season, including an embarrassing game on April 10, 1999, against the Miami Heat. The Miami Heat beat the Bulls by a score of 82-49. Yes, you heard me right. 49 points. 49 points the Bulls scored. The Bulls set an all-time low for points scored in the shot clock era, an all-time low. That's an incredible accomplishment, as I'd imagine that a team that's currently tanking like the Knicks would score more points even if they tried throwing the game. The team shot 23% from the floor and they didn't even hit a single three-pointer that game. The best player for that game was David Cornet, and nobody knows who the hell he is. Dreadful. This is also a home game as well. Every Bulls fan left that arena embarrassed, and they have every right to be embarrassed after experiencing that. The Bulls went on to have a 5-game losing streak, and they would proceed to lose 7 of their last 8 games in the season. Isn't that nice? One of those games included Ron Harper and Brent Barry's last game in the Bull uniform. The Bulls ended the 1998-99 season by being the worst team in the Eastern Conference, with a record of 13 wins and 37 losses. This is the second time in league history that the defending champs missed the playoffs. The first time the defending champs missed the playoffs were the 1969 to 1970 Boston Celtics. Chicago ranked dead last in offensive rating with a rating of 92.4. Chicago's defensive rating wasn't that good, but hey, it wasn't the worst, as they finished 16th with a rating of 103. One thing I will say, Chicago ranked first in attendance. You gotta give credit to those loyal Bulls fans for sticking behind their team, no matter how shit they are. If you're bad, at least you have a chance of getting a high pick in the draft. In fact, Chicago won the 1999 NBA draft lottery, as they had the third highest chance of winning it behind the Vancouver Grizzlies and the Clippers.
Vancouver Grizzlies. And that means that the first pick in the 1999 NBA draft goes to the Chicago Bulls.
Since their last lottery appearance 10 years ago, the Chicago Bulls have won 6 titles on pure talent. Today, they win the NBA's draft lottery on pure luck.
The Bulls had the first overall pick and the 16th pick acquired from the Luke Longley trade. Elton Brand was selected first overall as the Bulls lacked a true big man, as their best big man the season before was Dickie Simpkins, who was a reserve during the second three-peat. Chicago drafted Ron Artest with their 16th pick, as they also lacked a wing player. Aside from Tony Kukoc, the Bulls had that David Cornet guy and Keith Booth. The 1998-99 Bulls was a bad team. Probably the worst team in Bulls history. I could say definitely the worst Bulls team in the post-Jordan era. This team lacked any direction, lacked talent, lacked experience, and I feel bad for every Bulls fan that witnessed this team. But after the 1999 draft, there was a bright future, a hope that they could finally make it back to the playoffs, one day as Jerry Krause was ready to show everybody that he could make another great dynasty. This was MBG, and I'm out of here.